Oh, wow.
So sorry. Was he a believer?
He was as of 3 weeks ago. He was very
wow. Praise the Lord.
Her pastor came to the house and he accepted the Lord.
Wow.
Praise the Lord, huh?
It's unbelievable how good I'm doing. And I'm a believer.
Amen.
So I'm with you.
Okay.
Well, his nose is looking better. He finally allowed me to see his nose this last week.
It's healing.
Oh, my God.
It's healing nicely.
I was delivered excellently.
Carl, if you'll lie a little bit more, it'll probably go back to you.
I think it's improved my looks. How about that?
But, bump.
Well, I went this week and had a couple biopsies. I'm hiding it a little bit with Betsy's makeup.
Betsy didn't
even know. I dabbed some of her makeup on there, so it didn't look quite so noticeable. But so I should hear back in another week as to whether or not there are little cancers that have to be further procedure. Basal cell stuff. You know, it's like every year when I go to the dermatologist, I have to find something.
That's their job.
Maybe pray for Dot, because she's kind of up and down what's happening with her. She told me last time I talked to her, what was it? Her dizzy unsteadiness was keeping her, was the worst at this time. And I know she hadn't been here for a couple weeks. Do you know anything else?
I don't know.
But yeah, I'd like to pray for Dot. Oh, she did. Praise the Lord. Well, we'll pray. That's good.
And now we need a prayer for this man right here. He went in and had a most procedure on the side of his face, but his blood pressure was so high, when they did it, they couldn't close it up.
What?
He got another hole in his head. He had all the help that you get for him to keep his blood pressure down. So they can close it next Thursday when we go back.
Uh-huh. Oh, my gosh.
Pray, shall we? Anybody who feels led to pray, please do.
Thank you, Father. Father, I just thank you for what you're doing in each of our lives. I thank you for Carl's healing and restoration. I thank you that Dad is feeling well enough to be able to visit family. And enjoy. I just pray you'd bless her time up there. I ask that you would bless if Barbara's able to come today, all would go well, and she would just be happy and refreshed to be back with everybody again. I just ask your blessing on Linton and Joy, that you would be with them. Help Joy in the caretaking that she provides 24/7. Give her strength and wisdom. Thank you, Lord. And for Linda, who's off helping her sister, Alice. I just pray that your hand would be on that. You would be with her and help her as she ministers to her sister.
Amen. Father God, I ask that you would send a cleansing to the election processes of this country. Send your Holy Spirit, send your holiness and righteousness to this nation in its election process. We just release your judgments and deliverance to establish integrity in the voting procedures of this season and for all seasons of voting in this country. We demand that the enemy completely release its grip on the nation's elections in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Father, I release your heavenly justice to replace the deceptions, the manipulations, the thefts, in the election balloting and the popular voting and the people's referendums. Let your deliverance flow from the national to the local levels in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
Let there be peace in this nation.
Mm-hmm.
And we give you glory and honor,
Lord,
for your mercy and grace in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father.
Mm-hmm.
As you were 2,000 years ago, you have not changed. You are still
God. Yes, God.
I pray that the Christian community, Lord God, in the midst of all of this, will truly stand firm in you, will find peace in you, and that you, O Lord, in the midst of this, will be lifted up. And Lord,
Lord, we thank you for bringing us together again. We thank you, Lord, for our freedom of assembly, for this time that we can come together in agreement in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the power of agreement as we lift these requests to you, Lord. We thank you that you hear our prayers and that you are faithful, Lord, to answer, Lord, and to bring miracles, and Lord, turn around. You specialize in turning around the impossible and making all things possible. And so, Lord, we thank you that this morning you are on your throne and that you have everything under control.
That's good.
And Lord,
thank you,
you will cause all things to work out for good. So we lean on you today, Lord. We put our trust in you. We want to keep our eyes on you, Lord. We agree today, Lord, for Ken's blood pressure to come down so that they can finish this procedure this week. We just speak healing over him in
mm-hmm.
Jesus' name.
Yes.
Complete Lord, we continue to ask you to bring an end to this COVID crisis,
yes,
COVID
Lord.
Pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we do, Lord, I in particular this morning pray for our teachers and teachers across the land who are trying to teach the children in the midst of this craziness.
Yes,
and
Lord.
They are all worn out, Lord, and completely exhausted and fatigued. And I just pray, Lord, that you will bring an end to this and that you will restore restore their strength, and Lord, bring a solution to us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And this morning, as we study the scriptures again, Lord, we ask you to be with us as we look at John 15, guide our discussion. Lord, open our understanding. Teach us by your Spirit this morning. We ask in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So we're in John chapter 15. We're continuing with our theme about love. And today's lesson is abiding love. John 15, verses 4 through 17. Josiah, would you like to read those verses for us?
Sure.
4 through 17. So Jesus gives two commands in our passage today. The first command, or imperative, abide in me. I like the King James terminology there.
Yeah.
Abide in me. I like that word, abide. The NIV says remain in me. It's interesting. This word is important to Jesus. He uses it 7 times during this little short conversation. Abide in me. He uses this word abide, which can be translated remain, stay, wait.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I like the word abide because I grew up hearing the hymn, Abide in Me, that old hymn.
Mm-hmm.
But the other command, Bill?
Interesting, back in chapter 14, 20 and 21, in that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Verse before that says, you will behold me, because I live, you shall live also. So he's referring to his resurrection. In that day, you'll know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you.
same word. It's that same word. Yes, remain in me. Abide. Stay connected. Stay
focused.
Stay completely connected. And it, the connected part, he goes on to explain a little bit about that, you know, using the metaphor of a vine, which would have been very familiar to his audience then, and I think it's familiar to us too. We know how a vine works, or the trunk of a tree, the trunk of a bush, a vine. I don't know if any of you have ever had grapevines.
Sure.
But he says, I am the vine, you are the branches. So it's the way, you know, a branch is connected to a vine or to a tree trunk. That's the idea he's conveying there, you know, about abiding, remaining, staying attached, staying connected to him. Because he goes on to say, because apart from me, you can do nothing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is profound, you mm-hmm. guys. Apart from him, we can do nothing. Ken?
I heard an explanation in a little research about, again, realizing that as Gentiles, we have been grafted into the vine. And I learned some years ago, that whole concept of taking something and grafting it into a tree is a very delicate process. We have trees now, we have fruit trees now where they have a tree, but it bears multiple fruit. You can get something that has a nectarine and a tangerine,
right,
all in one tree.
Right.
And it's because of that grafting process. But what has to happen is they have to cut far enough into the main tree that it hits what's called the heartwood, which is the main center core of the tree where all the nutrients and things come up. If it goes too far, you can actually kill the tree. At the same time, if you don't go far enough, the graft doesn't take.
Yeah.
And so this whole concept of trees and branches, and for me as a Gentile, understanding how delicate and how precious being grafted into the vine, that analogy really, for me, brought home just how special and how specific and how delicate that process was for us being grafted into Jesus. We're touching the heart of God.
Right.
And if we ever lose that connection as a branch, if we don't have that connection with the heart of God, as someone grafted in, we'll die. We'll wither. Because we don't receive the nutrients we want. And for me, that's what makes this really powerful.
And so I want us to circle back to this, but that it is powerful. And, you know, being connected to him as the vine not only keeps us alive, because Ken's right, if a branch becomes unattached, it withers and dies. On the other hand, if the branch stays attached, what does it do?
It grows and it bears fruit.
It bears fruit. And so he goes on to talk about, you know, the positive aspect of remaining in him. If you remain in him, like a branch, you're going to bear fruit, a lot of good fruit. So we're going to circle back to this in just a minute. But I want to get back to the passage having two commands. This is the first command, abide in me. What is the second command?
Love each other.
Love. That's right. And so this is kind of it's a reiteration of what he said in last week's passage. Last week's passage, he gave a new commandment. You remember that back in the 13th chapter, verses 34 and 35? Somebody read those for us real quick. 13 verses 34 and 35.
I got 34. Oh. A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another.
By this, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. But he calls it a new commandment. The new commandment I give you, love one another like I have loved you. And I think that's the new aspect of it, because, you know, Jesus has affirmed before that even in the law, in the old covenant, it all was about love. And he said all of the law hangs on the two commandments of loving God and loving your fellow man. And so loving is not a new command, but the new command, the new part of his command, is loving each other as he has loved us. There's a new aspect to it.
Mm-hmm.
Love each other, he says, love each other the way I have loved you. And so it's interesting that he commands us to love. Because some people would say, well, you know, how can you be forced to love? Well, we can talk about that. But he says it several times. He says it in John 13. Then in this passage this week, John 15:12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So he repeats it. He reiterates it. And then he says it again, John 15, verse 17. This is my command, love each other. So he's really wanting us to get this. This is my command, guys.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to love each other.
Right.
And even go so far as to say, in 14, you're my friend.
Yeah.
You do what I command.
Mm-hmm. You're my friends if you do what I command.
I know this is a step over, but I'm thinking about unrepentant sin. You know, there's no expectation that we're never going to sin, but unrepentant sin takes you away from the fight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're not seeking forgiveness, you're a step away. You're not a friend of the Lord Jesus. You're not following that command. You know, unrepentant sin, that's what
it is. Amen.
It's death. Yeah. And it doesn't matter how.
Is there any forgiveness without repentance?
Absolutely not.
I think forgiveness is contingent upon repentance.
Mm-hmm.
Is that different than what we're committed to do? Because we're committed to forgive other people, whether they are repentant or not.
Well, you know, where he says, forgive somebody 70 times 7, you know, when Peter was like, am I supposed to forgive somebody 7 times? That's, you know, the context of that is somebody asking for forgiveness. If somebody comes to me and apologizes and asks me to forgive them, am I supposed to forgive them 7 times? And Jesus said 70 times 7.
But what about the people that don't? I mean, I've always felt and thought, we were taught, if somebody does us wrong, we still have a responsibility to forgive them, whether they're repentant or not. It doesn't mean that they're absent of consequences.
But that's for yourself.
Yeah, that's for your sake.
Well,
I don't know that. Yeah, so you don't harbor unforgiveness. Yeah, you know, but there's a whole discussion, and we won't unravel that this morning. We'll have to save that for another time.
Yeah.
But there's a whole school of thought around the, you know, the fact of the idea that forgiveness only, we're only obligated to forgive when somebody has asked for it and repented. So we're not going to unravel that this morning. I've struggled with that, and I come down on the other side of that debate where I just feel like it's my obligation to forgive. If I feel like I've been wrong, whether the person is repentant about it, whether they're apologetic, whether they've been willing to try to reconcile, in spite of, regardless of any of that, my job is to forgive them and give it to God.
Mm-hmm.
And let you know, as far as getting right with God, the way I understand Scripture is, in order to get right with God, you have to repent.
I don't question that at all. You know, it's just, it's interesting. Again, there's a difference here.
There is. But you know, the universal salvation folks believe that everybody's going to be saved regardless. That God's forgiveness is going to cover everybody's sins regardless. Even the devil's going to, the people who hold that theology, they believe even the devil's going to get saved. So I don't see that in the Scriptures.
Yeah.
I don't see that in the Scriptures, so I don't buy it.
I mean, to me, this is something I'm working on with my brother. But in Galatians 5:19, now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are, they go through immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, dispute, dissension, faction, envy, drunkenness, carousing, things like these. Who hasn't been drunk? Anyway, carousing, things like these. I forewarn you, just by the forewarning, that those who practice such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Right.
Shall not inherit.
And that's the flip side of the good stuff that comes from the Holy Spirit.
And right after that are the fruit of the Spirit.
The fruit of the Spirit, which, go ahead and read those, Galatians 5:22-23.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law.
The fruit of the Spirit. And I'm not even sure that's an exhaustive list. He gives examples there. We talk about the nine fruit of the Spirit, but I'm not sure that there are only nine. He just rattles off a bunch of them. Characteristics or manifestations of the kind of fruit that the Holy Spirit brings forth in our lives. And that's what Jesus is talking about. And he says, if you remain in me, you're going to bear much good fruit. And he's talking about that stuff.
Right.
That Paul starts listing off in Galatians. Yes.
Again, sort of rerouting this a little bit, because Bill brought out a great example of this tie-in of Jesus and abiding in me and things that's through John. And it's really hidden in verse 7. Where he says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you. You know, again, it's not me and, it's if you abide in me, if you abide in me.
Right.
And my words. They're tied in together.
Right.
And I saw that, and then it brought me back to John 1.
Right.
In the beginning was the Word.
Right.
And the Word is God, and the Word was God. And so again, to me, that so encapsulates that whole concept of abide.
Amen.
And as far as it's Jesus, he is the Word of God, and he is in our hearts. And that's just, for me, it's such a strong tie-in of the entire chapter, just like Bill was showing, as far as abiding in me and how abide.
Yeah, and you know, in the same way that he's reiterating his command to love, you know, he is correlating it with us staying in abiding, staying connected to him. He says, "Remain in me, or abide in me. No branch can bear fruit by itself; it must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain or abide in me," he says. "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing." So, it's all contingent. You know, our ability to survive and thrive and bear fruit is staying connected to him. And you know, that word told his guys in this same conversation, he says, look, I'm going away, but I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm going to send back the Comforter. I'm sending back the Holy Spirit. And so, and the reason for this is so that the Father and I will be able to come and make our abode in you. That's amazing, isn't it?
Yes.
We will make our abode in you. They're going to come and take up residence in us.
Instead of the temple.
Yeah. We are the temple.
We are the temple.
Well, the temple.
Yeah. So, you know, that abiding, it's part of the same root as an abode. You abide in your abode. And that abode is that dwelling place. You know, and he says, I'm coming back. The Father and I are going to come and take up residence. We're going to abide in you. So, that's a comforting thing, guys. I mean, and he's constantly, you know, reminding us. He just like he reminded the church. He says, "I stand at the door and knock. If you'll hear my voice and open up the door, I'll come in and sup with you, dine with you." It's that intimacy, you know, and that relationship. That's part of the remaining and abiding.
We have to
open the door. That's right. So, you know, it's part of this is a responsibility that we have the privilege of sharing in. He gives us an imperative. He says, look, you abide in me. Remain in me. It's something we have to take responsibility for, of staying connected to him.
That's right.
It's not just going to happen by accident.
That's right.
We have to be deliberate about it. So I want to talk a little bit before we run completely out of time about this I am divine. He says I am divine. It's one of his I am statements.
Right.
And there are seven of them. Usually people count seven of them in the Gospel of John, the seven I ams of Jesus. But I like to include an eighth one. I'll go down to seven of them first. And I know Billy Graham preached a sermon that became a very, very famous sermon on the Jesus I Ams, and he focused on seven of them. I am the bread of life, Jesus said, John 6. I am the light of the world, he said in John 8:12. I am the door, he said, John 10:7-9. I am the resurrection and the life. John 14, verse 6. No, I'm sorry, that was John 11, 25. I quoted you the wrong reference on that. I am the good shepherd. John 10, 14. I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14, 6. I am the vine. John 15, in today's passage. And the other one that I like to throw in, the eighth one, is I am he, Jesus said. When they came, they said, when they came into the garden to arrest him, the soldiers, he said, who are you looking for? And they said, we're looking for Jesus. He said, I am he. Remember what happened? When Jesus said, I am he, John 18, verse 6, they drew back and fell to the ground.
Yeah, that's fine.
Why do you think that happened?
Power of God.
They were struck by the power of God?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Bill?
John 8:58. He said, I am. Before Abraham was, I am.
That's true. He did just say, I am. What was that reference?
John 8:58.
John 8:58. I don't remember. You look at it. You see if you can find it for us. Yeah, he did say before Abraham was, I am. You know, he said, I I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning.
And you know that that's likened unto what God said to Moses.
Exactly.
Yes.
Moses said,
right.
Who will I say sent me, when they want to know who sent me?
That's right.
And God said, tell them, I am sent you.
Tell them, I am sent you. Yeah, and that's, you know, that's the Hebrew name of God, Yahweh, as best we can figure out how to pronounce it. And they wouldn't even say it because they felt like the name was so holy. They wouldn't say it. And when they spelled it, they just used consonants with no vowels in there. And they didn't want to write the name completely, so they left out the vowels. And they never wanted to speak his name, so they would replace it with the word Lord. But, you know, because Jesus has reconciled us to God and he has brought us into the most holy place, we can approach the throne of God with confidence and with boldness. And we have that intimacy with the Father now that we're on a first name basis with him. And he no longer considers us servants and slaves, but he considers us friends. And so, yes, you know, we can call him Papa. That's the kind of relationship we have with him.
Abba,
Papa,
Father.
Daddy. That's the intimate relationship we have with him. Thanks to Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
But I love the I am statements. Whenever Jesus says I am, it should get our attention. Amen. Amen. So, you know, the importance of obedience, circling back to what you were saying. If, you know, you are my friends, if you do as I say, you know, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. You know, the obedience factor is part of it. And so, knowing that his disciples would be facing fear and anxiety, he told them that they would have help. They're even going to have help. We are going to have help even in obeying. So that's part of the work of the Holy Spirit too. The Holy Spirit helps us obey. The Holy Spirit helps us repent. I'm not sure we're even able to repent without his help.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That's really when we're praying for our country. Our country is going to have God's help, the help of the Holy Spirit,
sure,
to repent and come back to God.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm constantly praying that the Lord will send a spirit of repentance across the land,
mm-hmm,
to turn our hearts back to him. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Well, we're out of time. Anybody have any other questions or comments? It is a good lesson.
Yeah, very good. Very good.
It is.
Input from everybody.
Well, we know where our priority could be.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've been amazed recently reading how Jesus himself set his face towards being obedient, fixed his eyes on the Father,
mm-hmm,
making his way to Calvary, and how he fixed, you know, he had to fix his eyes. And, you know, we're told to fix our eyes on Jesus and, you know, keep that, our mind, set our mind on the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and doing that may mean for some of us, that I know it does for me, that I turn off the TV.
Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you right now, I'm not listening to news.
No.
I'm not going on social media.
No,
if for me to keep my eyes on the Lord right now, I don't need to be listening to all that stuff.
Amen.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, and the sad fact is that even believers and followers are being distracted from where they should be. People that I follow, that I've listened to, that should be glorifying Jesus right now more than ever, instead are distracted. And that's one thing that I'm praying for, the focus, the clarity, the truth and the trust, you know, unequivocal trust, and the fact that he's king and he's in control, and that's who I trust.
Yes.
So. Amen. Pablo, do you mind having our closing prayer for us?
Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that we're here to gather. We gather here in your name, Jesus, to glorify you this morning, to learn, to study your word, and to be reassured and knowing that your word is the truth, is what guides us, is what allows us to continue to just look forward to another day. We lift up those that are hurting right now throughout our nation, those that are confused right now, those that are unable to focus to you, and so we want that destruction to go away, and that your Holy Spirit covers this land and protects us. We give you the glory in all, and we wanna just magnify your name across this land and the world, as you taught us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.